Committee. Welcome to the Adult Care Health Overview Scrutiny Committee, the last one for the fiscal year. So we'll go again. Right, we do have one apology this evening, and that's Karen Pryor from Health Watch. Do we have any other apologies that we don't know about?
Councillor Potty has had to go to.
Okay, is he on his way or?
I don't think so.
And do we have any member declarations of interest? Sharon?
Thanks, Chair. I'm one of the children and the NHS.
Christina?
I'm a daughter of one daughter working in the NHS and one daughter of GP.
Gerry?
Two daughters working in the NHS.
Gerry?
My daughter works in the NHS and she's a work for the local council.
My daughter in the NHS.
Yes, I'm the governor of the CWP NHS Foundation Trust appointed by the council.
And Lesley?
I work for the NHS and I'm also a local council member.
And Gerry?
I work for the NHS and I'm a company secretary for
the NHS. Okay, thank you all. Can we all look at the minutes, pages 1 to 12, and do we have any amendments to make on those? We haven't got any matters arising, it's only for accuracy, Tony. Can we just check for accuracy first?
Yes, sure.
Is that okay?
Thank you, sorry.
It's all right. Okay.
£800,000 sum for reinvestment into public council services supporting the delivery of public health outcomes. So I'm just curious about the £800,000, what other services it's going to be going to, and how that relates back to the services.
So you're just looking for clarification, could you answer that?
Yeah, I don't have the full clarification today. There are things like leisure services, but in terms of the breakdown, I don't have that directly. But I can come back to Scrutiny with the detail of that.
Oh, that's great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, can we have
the
move on to the
Scrutiny
Service update? We've got David Hammond and Simon Banks, I believe. You want to?
David, is that, sorry, if you want to just pop up there. Nice to see you
again, David. I used to work with you some
time ago. Okay, over to you. So it's worth saying I'm not Simon Banks, obviously. So I'm Mark Richards, I'm the Chief Finance Officer, Chief Executive of the Community Trust. I'm David Hammond, I'm
Can I just say, if you, as you said, the middle button there is when you're speaking into the mic. Thank you.
Do you keep it pressed down when speaking?
No,
just
press it
and
then
it's on.
Yeah,
put it back on. On my own way.
Yeah.
So I'm David Hammond, Associate Director of Partnerships and Strategic Development of the Trust for Community Energies Management Trust. We work closely with both the phlebotomy team, the divisional team, and the practices that we were. Providing a shared service for. So you have the paper in front of you. Would you like me to run through the key points within the paper without useful and then So just to summarise some of those key points then. We've been a long-standing provider of bottom services in Wallasey since 2011. In 2017, so the year before last, the lobotomy, the contract model changed, so that rather than there being a main contract that was held with ourselves as a community trust, the budget for lobotomy was given to each individual practice of each of the 51 general practices within Wirral, and they then had the choice to set as to how they spend that money to provide lobotomy for their patients. The service specification that the CCG members agreed was broadly similar to that previous, so it was a combination of walking and pre-booked appointments, domiciliary appointments and for adults and children. So that led to the development of a number of different phlebotomy models within Wirral. I believe seven, don't quote me on that. We were providing model on behalf of, we are providing model on behalf of 22 of the 51 practices. And then others, some others are provided on a standard basis, and others are working within other groupings as well. We formed a co-management group with representatives from the 22 practices to identify how to make best use of the resources available to those practices, and therefore to ourselves as a subcontractor to each of those. And arrived at a model which was focused on providing pre-booked appointments at a number of the practices in the mornings, and then walk-in access in three pubs in the afternoons. And that was to strike a balance of providing appointments closer to people's own practices, but then also making the walk-in access that's required. What we expected was to see a reduction in some of the domiciliary activity. Because domiciliary activity is proportionally much more time intensive for lobotomists to provide residents, but you have to travel to somebody's home to do the bleed and then travel to the next person. So it's more resource intensive, at least four times more so than a standard pre-booked or walking appointment. And I think that's one of the reasons why, because we haven't seen a substantial change in that level of domiciliary activity. But we've seen pressure both on the pre-bookables and the walk-in access. And so the pre-bookables are booked well in advance, and the walk-in access, anybody who knows someone who's good for a walk-in appointment will know that, particularly around about the 1 o'clock time slot when walk-in access opens up, there's already people waiting because they know that they want to be seen and they want to guarantee a slot for themselves. But that puts a lot of pressure right at that opening time within the hub, which also means not only is it poor experience for those people who've been waiting for some time to be assured that they're seen, but also means that people coming through after 1 o'clock are almost guaranteed to wait for them themselves, and equally people coming at maybe 3:30 might be turned away because of the services open and runs until 5. Once there's a certain number of people in the queue, the philosophers, the staff there know that they can't physically see all of the people who are waiting past a certain point. It takes 5 minutes to carry out a bleed. So, with that understanding, we looked for an alternative way of providing this model. It was something that we worked on with the practices, because again, it's just to emphasise, we're a subcontractor to those 22 practices, and we have an individual contract with each of the 22. So constructed an alternative model with the 22 practices that we believe will be more effective, just essentially making more effective use of the resource available, focused more on providing walk-in access to remove that 1 o'clock surge. And providing pre-bookable appointments alongside the walk-in appointments, and co-locating them. And the reason for co-locating them was because we believed it would make a more efficient use of the resources available. If no one booked in, then the office can take some from the fewer people waiting for a walk-in appointment. So we believed it would be a more effective model. We jointly took that to the primary care co-commission committee in January, and that was rejected, and provided some reasons for that, particularly around the inequity of access, as we see. So we have seven different models providing in a number of different ways, but I think quite it is a fact that what our model did was reduce the number of locations available where people could have guilt taken. So with that decision made, we took a really difficult decision as an organisation, in discussion with the practices as well, that we didn't feel we could provide a model that fit the service specification and that also also reduce waiting times to an acceptable level. And at that point we gave notice to the 22 practices, that was the end of January. So the practices are currently looking at how they will meet the service specification, their contract with the commissioners. We understand that they should be responding by the middle of April with their model. We don't know, but we've had discussions with them and have offered support and also invited them to share the same plans that we have, because there may well be opportunities for our forgotten staff with the practices. That's a decision that they need to make, and they're developing their approaches as individual groups of practices. And then, of course, alongside that, and I've mentioned it, really significant is the impact on our staff. And we have met with the staff, we've kept our staff informed throughout, so this has been a really difficult process, but we've kept them as informed as we possibly can. Last week we started the consultation process around in our organisational change policy. So we will be looking very, very hard for opportunities within the organisation where those staff can be redeployed. There are a number of opportunities we have identified, number of areas we've identified where opportunities may lie. And what will happen next is joint consultation with the staff as a group, but also one-to-one and individual consultation to understand people's individual circumstances and understand what might be the best fit for them. So that process is ongoing as well. So that's a summary of the paper. Very happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, David.
If
you could just ask you to lock your mic off. Okay, do you have any questions, please? I'll take Maura, Phil, and Bruce.
Thanks, Chair. And thank you very much for that. Your explanation of why you're not in a position to continue the service. I have to say that phlebotomy has been. The quality of service about phlebotomy has been brought to our attention here on a number of occasions over the last couple of years, and it has been a cause of concern for us. I accept that you had a rationale for the proposals that you made. However, I don't see, and I see that 20 of the 22 practices are happy. I'm not sure where the patients fit into that, whether they were part of any consultation that you did, but a reduction to almost half of the locations would inevitably prove difficult, I think, for quite a few people, particularly the transport links in the borough not being as good as they could be. But my primary question is around going forward. I mean, what I'm looking for, and what I'm sure the committee is looking for, is that they get an adequate service for those people who need it going forward. So I'm not quite clear what's going to happen after the 1st of July. If, from what you say, nobody is. And that must be a cause of concern. So when will this committee be told what services are going to be provided for Boxing in the Borough after the 1st of July?
Yeah, so honestly, we can't answer that because we're not actually commissioned to provide the service any longer. As Dave's explained, it's each of the individual GP practices are now paid to provide this service, and they are in the process of developing their plans.
Each
so they get each individual practice then. Some of the practices have already found their methodology.
Some of the practices are very keen to take it back on.
Yeah, so they're pulling together their plans now, and as Dave referred to, mid-April is the timeline for those plans to be presented back to the CCG. But we couldn't honestly comment on them because it's not
in that case, Chair, can I request that when we come back in September, for those of us who know for certain that we will be back on this committee, can we have a report when we come back to the meeting in September on what provisions now will be in place at that point across the borough, please? Thank you.
I'm a little bit concerned the length of time, because obviously the next meeting will be in September, as you say. I wonder whether there's any way that we could have a meeting prior to that.
Excuse me, Chair, I think there might be a meeting before that, June.
Yes, I think June, yeah, I think June, we'll ask.
I meant the first meeting, sorry, Chair.
I mean, I can see Simon at the back there, I'm sorry to bring you in, Simon, but unexpectedly, is that something that the CCG would come back and report on, do you think?
Yes, Chair.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that, Simon, we'll do that then in June. Okay, Phil.
Thank you, Chair. I'm hardly an expert on anything medical, so blame them here. I happened to drop into Eastern Walking Centre yesterday because a friend was having a blood test. And I popped my head around the door and the room was packed. In fact, my friend asked for permission from people there to take a photograph of the scene because every chair seemed to be occupied to me. And I was there about 2 o'clock. With your permission, Chair, I did have an email from a constituent, which I think I've circulated to the spokespersons. So I'll read it, not lengthy, but it gives a picture of what's happening and confirms some of the picture that he was confirmed. My doctor told me to attend Eastern Walking between 1 and 5pm yesterday for tests, so that would be the 3rd of March. I arrived at 12:50 to find the last parking space. The waiting room was packed and the receptionist told me there'd be a 2-hour wait. I was told St Cath's or Victoria Hospitals were the only other options. I drove straight to St Cath's where there's now a car parking attendant, given the sheer volume of cars arriving at just after 1pm. I visited the hospital many times before, never seen the car park so busy. I arrived at the bottom of it around 1:20 to find it totally overcrowded. I decided to go back to Eastern at 4:30, only to be told they've reached their daily quota. I've been advised to return today at midday and wait an hour before the service opens. At least that way I'll be seen. So a subsequent email from that lady says the next day I got there at 11:45, and although number one in the queue was seen at 1:30 p.m. Needless to say, the waiting room was full, all chairs occupied, all waiting for a blood test. Sorry about the length of that, but it's a picture which I think is fair, as a number of people have spoken to me in weeks about it. I'm just going to work this through in my sort of spot-like, logical way, forgive me. If we add up the total number of people who need to go to the doctors or go to their surgeries in the mornings and then need to go to the walk-ins in the afternoon, that's a certain number of phlebotomy, certain number of phlebotomy interventions where people are taking samples. Certain number of them. So we've got a picture of how many people need it. So when it goes back to the doctors seem to be putting bits of idea of what they're going to offer. First of all, should be a process to work out, does that bit meet the number of people likely to want phlebotomy from that community, likely to come forward? Again, a layman, perhaps doctors are very keen on sending people for blood tests nowadays, I've no idea. But is there a general pattern in blood tests that we need to account for and be prepared for? I come back to the issue of the phrase, all right, there may be opportunities for staff. Because what's clearly been unsettling is when citizens have gone to the walk-in and been told by staff, and I appreciate it's still early days, we're going to lose our jobs in June. Now, of course, consultation has now started, but that message is still, we're losing our jobs in June, and someone's talking where we're going, and it was very unsettling for somebody doing it. So, I entirely agree, Chair, that we should have something to our committee in June, and it should show us what the pattern, the emerging pattern is. But we'd also expect some guarantees from the CCG that they've been monitoring this emerging pattern to make sure that if there appear to be gaps, then those gaps are tackled. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, so I've got about 4 points to respond to, and I would think if I've missed something, please let me know. So I think, first of all, the picture you paint is really clear. I think it illustrates why we've took a very difficult decision to give notice on the on those 22 contracts, because we don't think that is what we should expect for our patients. or it's not what we aspire to for patients, nor our staff actually, who are understandably dealing with the brunt of people's frustration in that situation. So that really is going really well, thank you. Over time, we have seen an increase in demand for forgotten services. I think this reflects the greater availability of tests and other things such as NHS health checks and things like that. So I think over time we do see a pattern of increase. Where, obviously, as we discussed, there's seven of the models in play at the moment. I think where we've come from, so historically, obviously, we were the main provider of forgotten services and therefore include full-time forgotten staff with a team manager. Where some of the other models are different and where practice is able to operate differently is taking a different approach to the way they provide phlebotomy. So certainly utilising healthcare assistants who might do some healthcare assistant tasks as part of the time, they do phlebotomy for other parts of the time. So I think they've got an opportunity to utilise their roles and skills differently within practices, which is not something that our model lends itself to. And I think probably also the approach to where practices are doing things themselves within their practice, it's likely that they take a different approach to managing the demand within the practice, just because it's closer to home. That's not a commentary on anything other than just I think you'd expect different approaches to the way in which the bottom should be provided. So just because our model with full-time phlebotomists hasn't been able to build that demand, it doesn't mean that the model is good. Just as something to be aware of. And then the last point is, it just comes back to the staff, and just to reiterate that we are making every effort to look for redeployment opportunities, and it's not a surprise either when the staff heard and told them first, before we gave notice to practices that we would be doing something, because we didn't want them to hear when the next day when they went into one of the practices, that they were worried and they were shocked by it, and that is understandable. I hope now that we've entered the process properly and have the opportunity to discuss the things that they may want to do within our organisation
Can I just follow something up, Chair, that does occur to me? If I say 51941, everyone here knows what 51941 is. The practice is, I just picture practices being your autonomous individual practices, different sizes, whatever, making their own arrangements. Within Wirral, are we now not having these nine operating units of practices cooperating with a manager over them to find out what local needs are? So, assuming the grouping has some convenient locations within it, then I rather hope that there will be some flexibility within that model that would add or enable perhaps a quicker response in terms of phlebotomy. Perhaps the CCG, the best place is the contractor who's going, is the people that's coming in that really want to get a grip off to find out exactly what's going to be in place for people who have to go there. Thank you.
Did you want to come back on that,
David?
Happy to. I think you've already identified that it's a question for. What does the system look like in future, and does what the city within these neighbourhoods? I think the models that are there at the moment probably don't. They don't reflect that, but then I don't think they were created at a time when the neighbourhood model was to the fore. But I think you have a mixed question for the colleagues as well as to whether that what might change in the future.
Sure. There is, if you look, just forgive me. I'm very pleased that you've brought the report forward. It's helpful for us to know the reasons why. But when we get a report on a change of service, surely it's the people who are going to provide and take over the service, or the people who are responsible for the service, that should be coming to us and telling us what's changing in the service, not to the people who are no longer going to provide the service. And as I say, I'm very grateful to you for coming and giving us your explanation, but actually, I'm wondering why we haven't got a report saying there's going to be a change in the delivery of service, which is the way it should be done.
I agree, but then we're looking at the question number of practices.
Well, there's a commissioning body, isn't there?
Sorry?
There's a commissioning body.
There is a commissioning body, and I don't think that you're in a position. My understanding is that you're not in a position yet.
Chair, we weren't asked to provide the report. So the approach was made to Community Trust, Chair. We support the Community Trust in the writing of the report, but happy to answer any questions that arise tonight.
Okay, thank you. What I'm going to do then is continue to take questions that we have this evening. They may be directed to David and Mark. Simon, is there something you want to do at the table? In case you're able to answer some questions this evening.
Yes, that's okay. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to take Bruce next, and then I'm coming across to Sharon. Anybody else? Sorry, Tony, yes.
Thank you, Chair. Actually, Councillor McLaughlin asked my main question, which was to do with what happens after July of this year. And obviously, we don't know that at this point. And as she also said, we've looked at this issue on a couple of occasions previously. But I thought it actually been sorted once that we came up with the procedure in July of last year. And that was done in consultation with the GPs, which they seem to be happy with the service. Obviously, there is still a fault with the service. It seems to be grossly oversubscribed to. Is that a true fact to say it is now oversubscribed to, and is there a reason for that? And is the way to fix this situation, is it down to finances, is it down to extra resources? Do we have the resources in place to put this right? And that's it.
So based upon the modelling that was done in terms of letting the contract last July, which you were all party to as it came through scrutiny, the correct level of resource has been applied to this and it's been applied on the next usage and on also capitation basis. It's taken into account the fact that older people particularly use this service more than the young members of the population. It was a decision by the GP members of the CCG that they wished to pursue this angle, and 29 of the 51 practices are successfully delivering this service. We have had, as far as I'm aware, no complaints from those 29 practice areas. In terms of going forward, those 22 practices, I think Councillor McLaughlin absolutely nailed it in that actually it would have been ideal if those 22 practices could be questioned rather than the Community Trust, who is the subcontractor. And the Community Trust have done absolutely everything they can to make this service work. But they're not responsible for the delivery of it, they're a subcontractor. So what we've asked those 22 practices to do is look at a revised proposal that is congruent with the service specification that was agreed last July, because that's what they wanted to deliver, that's what they said they could deliver, that's what they wanted to deliver. So that is about home visiting, it's about practice or locally based reporting, it is about the service of children. They're currently developing those revised proposals and have to submit those to us as the Commissioners, Wirral Health and Care Commission, by the 12th of April. I picked up an action tonight, having spoken to David. Actually, that information also then needs to be shared fairly immediately with the Community Trust, because we do have, and I made this point last summer, we do have some of the lowest paid NHS employees working in this service, and we need to protect them as members of staff and ensure that we offer them an opportunity to continue in the new service offering as well. So that information is fairly urgent. We would also need to understand how we manage patient communications. But the decision we made by a joint committee of NHS England and the CCG on the 14th of May 2019. So that's a 6 week leading time to mobilise the new services for those 22 practices. So that's the position where we're in at the moment in terms of this. And as I said, I can only commend the CT for the work they've done to try and keep this running and working with us in terms of trying to make it happen. And not only in the last year, but the years previous to that, when they were actually the main contractor of the service.
Thank you. Thank you for stepping in, Simon. I'm going to move over to Sharon and Tony.
Thank you, Chair.
I just wanted to look at the tariffs and the background of the information that you've given with regards to the reduction of the total number of available locations from 15 to 8. I just wondered what the reason for that was. Is it purely a financial pressure? Have you got a root cause, for the reason to have to reduce those amounts of locations? Obviously, the service has been struggling, and you've not been able to provide the service at the GP specification. And again, it's just a question of why, really. My main concern, being a nurse in the NHS myself, is that I would like a reassurance from the CCJ that patients aren't let down with costly services. Data Mark is saying that you don't know what's going to happen from July, but I would like a reassurance from the CCJ that there's some kind of contingency plan in place so that patients aren't left without more tests and that their health is being put at risk as a result of that. Thank you.
On the point around the reduction of locations, so the majority of the locations that we provide in are GP practices, and those are spread across Wirral, and as I said, those are pre-booked appointments in the mornings. And then we've got three hub sites, the walk-in sites in the afternoons. Now in West Wirral, there isn't a good walk-in site, either through car parking or seasonal availability. So the pre-booked calls continue all day in West Wirral. And in the model we were proposing, we were maintaining the same broad geographical spread but with fewer locations in it. So therefore in Wallasey and West Wirral and South Wirral, the pre-book hall and the walk-in appointments would have been in the hub locations, so in sort of Victoria Central and St Catharines and Easton. And then in West Wirral, depending on the day of the week, we would have put pre-book hall appointments in two practices and run them all day. To move away from the phlebotomist having to travel during the middle of the day between the pre-booking and the walk-in. So really the new model is about making the best use of the resources we have available and essentially streamlining to remove any time that wasn't spent with patients as far as we possibly could. So that was the aim of it. And we were confident that it would work, but also accept the decision of the Primary Care Code Commissioning Committee that it was too far a move away from individual practices. We had to balance those two factors because we didn't think we could provide a really efficient service in that same number of locations, but the sort of specification talks of a associated with the practices. So that was the balancing act that we, as a provider that isn't hearing full-time from lottery staff, as I said earlier, because we have had to take that really difficult decision, and it was a really, Mark and I were both at the meeting where we made it was very hard. It doesn't mean that services being delivered within a practice or group of practices won't be successful because they have the ability to deploy staff in different ways to do that. The point on
So in terms of mobilisation, there would be a plan. Sorry, Chair. So we would be confident of having had by the 12th of April the plans back from the 22 practices as to what they're going to do about this. Clearly, a proportion of people in those 22 practices are not getting the service they should be getting in terms of phlebotomy, so we absolutely acknowledge that. If those plans are not sufficient, there would be a contingency in terms of asking other providers to step in to ensure we're. Phlebotomy service remains in place. David did actually capture there in terms of the delivery locations, reducing sites 15 to 8. We needed to understand impact assessments of that in terms of impact on patients, the delivery of the quality service provision across that. So, I mean, I hope you're getting the view that we've worked very closely together with this, on this with the Community Trust. We understand each other's position. We do have, however, have a specification that's been approved last summer about a convenient and accessible service within local GP practice and drop-in locations. Although, as Councillor Gilchrist pointed out, with the advent of the nine neighbourhoods, the development of them as service delivery units, it does give us an opportunity to look at it again. Our key issue, however, is that the 29 or so practices who are currently delivering the service are really part of one federation, and the others are a mixture as well. So actually we need the two federations also to work together on this across the whole 51 practices rather than a particular constituent groups. But with the NHS long-term plans pushed around units of 30 to 50,000 population, which are our neighbourhoods, then that is something we would be wanting, we are going to be looking at in much more detail around them as delivery units, which therefore means those services will be closer to those patients, those practices and so on, and those practices are working more closely together on geographical units rather than on federation lines.
Thank you, Chair. Just around the staff, just from my understanding, really, how many staff are we talking about? What's the stage of the redundancy notice? I'm aware that you've all had a redundancy notice. And what is the process of redeployment for the staff? Just take you through the staff journey, you're like, it must be really stressful for them.
Yeah, absolutely. And as I said before, we have through this whole process, through the redesign process, as well as more latterly, we have been keeping the staff informed and involved and using their views to inform the redesign that we developed. So we take that very, very seriously. 15 staff, 15 members of staff. There's more staff now that work in the service, but they're bank staff, so aren't affected in the same way. And as I said, last week we started the formal process. So the first stage of that is joint consultation, which is then followed by individual consultation. However, in this case, you know that's the sort of the standard schedule. I know that the manager within that division is meeting with the staff as and when, if they want a one-to-one meeting in advance of the formal process of that starting, that's happening. And I know that even today she had it's a template, it's a pro forma that describes skills and experience and aspirations and that kind of thing, and we're working with the staff too. So they will complete those and use them as the basis for their one-to-one interview, which then allows us to understand what they would ideally like to get from this process as well, because as we do have, and we have been scrutinising all of the potentially suitable opportunities within the organisation. That's not just within that division, so that's our urgent and primary care division, but our integrated children's division, our adult and community, all of these divisions will have opportunities that will open up. And then because they're on the redeployment register, if they are suitably qualified or experienced, or could be with additional support and training.
How long are they on the redeployment?
They now have the opportunity. So from now, so they have the opportunity to...
How long is that redeployment period? Is it 6 months? Is
it? It will be up until the end of the contract.
Just a supplementary information here. When you were redesigning the service from 15 locations to 8, were there going to be any redundancies or reductions in staff involved in that?
No.
Thank you.
Well,
I've
said
no more questions, so I'll just like to say thank you both for coming this evening. Sorry, we do have one supplementary question.
suggestion, if I may. We've heard that our committee meeting is the 26th of June. We've heard the dates from the Mr. Hammond and the CCG of the 12th of April and the 14th of May as key stages in the process. Would there be an opportunity for committee members to receive information by email on the shape that the proposed service is taking, so that we can satisfy ourselves that the new service is in place and that it's going to be convenient, accessible and staffed to meet the requirements?
We could do, well, Primary Care Commission Committee, but Primary Care Co-Commission Committee is a committee held in public. So it's a meeting in public. Therefore, the papers for that committee should be in the public domain. So I will look into it and we will release them. If it's a public item in the public domain, we can do it before the 14th of May. If not, it will be subsequent to the decision of the 14th of May, because clearly we'll have to do some public communications about what the service looks like. So I will look into and go back to you, Chair, about what we intend to do on that. But we will absolutely share it with the committee.
Right, so we have no more questions. I'd just like to thank you all for coming. Thank you, Simon, for staying in the very short notice. Right, if we can move on to item number five, Matthew Cox. Matthew, we're going to make us through the financial monitoring report.
Today to talk through the quarter three financial reports for adult health and care. Unfortunately, we've got no slides today. The slides that are prepared start on page 23 in your report pack, and they confirm and reinforce the things we've received. So we'll take everybody's attention to page 23. My attention, Chair, if it's okay with you, you should to write, read through those slides and then take questions at the end. So the main headlines for quarter three, there are a few points to raise. The revenue budget is still forecast to break even, thanks to the delivery of efficiencies throughout the year. And I will discuss those efficiencies shortly during this report. There has been an increased amount of community-based services this year, which has exceeded our own expectations, particularly in the home care sector. And again, I'll come on to that in a bit. There are pressures on the pool fund, which we'll discuss shortly, and the capital schemes have been revised, have been revised in light of the rest of implementation of a couple of schemes as well.